Hey guys, Five9 Gaming here, back with another Path of Exile video. And I say another, this is actually, I think, our first ever Path of Exile video, but we do want to sort of get into the scene. I know the game has been sort of exploding recently with all the content they've released, you know, the past few months, but this is one of, if not the biggest update we've seen in recent times, you know, with the new expansion coming out, Echoes of the Atlas, alongside the new league mechanic, the Ritual League. And in this specific video, I am Goresh, and we are joined by a first timer on the channel. Welcome to Omisid. What is going on?
Hey, thanks for having me. I'm really happy to be here.
Yeah, so if you guys like the content we're providing, feel free to leave us a like as well as subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, as well as leave a comment down below if you're interested in this sort of content, especially Path of Exile related, because again, this is our first ever Path of Exile video. But I want to start off the discussion by talking about the overarching themes of this upcoming expansion, Echoes of the Atlas. Basically, what this is like the new endgame content, effectively replacing the old Awakener quest line. And then before that, we had the Shaper and the Elder stuff, so sort of moving forward with that. And the way that they're basically replacing that is, you know, you'll be able to like refight, I think they mentioned, a bunch of the older defeated bosses all at the same time. And what did they say, up to like 10 at once? That's like the hardest difficulty.
Yeah, it's 3 to 10, with 10 being, you know, supposedly insane difficulty based on your map tier, and 3 being, I guess, relatively manageable.
Yeah. So, I mean, you mentioned this to me earlier, but it sounds like they're taking a page out of the Uber Elder fight for that.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, Uber Elder, Elder, Shaper, those are my favorite bosses pretty much from any video game ever. And the fact that Uber Elder was this really difficult fight, and they just took that base set of ideas and turned it into this hugely customizable boss arena where you can fight any set of bosses doing, you know, I'm sure there's some crazy interactions in there between the content. It's just really a great way to like incorporate that older idea into this newer, more fluid idea.
Right. And then at some point, I assume it's after you've cleared the hardest stage, that I think they did say was 10 at once, you'll be able to fight the Maven, who is supposedly just like the Shaper / Awakener of this expansion. So I guess that will sort of be like, you know, the new hardest boss in the game, so to speak. But to go along with that, the Maven will also be able to drop, you know, I assume much higher, better gear than you otherwise would have a chance to obtain from anywhere else. And then among those, you know, drops, you'll be able to obtain the Maven's orb, which, you know, I assume most people who've played the game over the past few months, basically like the updated version of, or I guess a different version of the Awakener's orb. It's called the Maven's orb. Just a crafting item that you'll be able to use to craft stuff, and I assume it's just going to be super rare and sought after. So, I mean, it's pretty basic stuff.
Yeah, but seems very cool.
The Ritual League itself, so let's get into this, because this is sort of like the heart of what's going to be transpiring over the course of the next few months as this league kicks off. By the way, the league is kicking off on January 15th, which I'm not sure what day this video is going up, because the announcement was on January 7th. This video is either going to be going up on the 7th or the 8th, so about a week from the time this video goes live. This league will be available to be played on the servers. So the Ritual League, essentially what it is a new mechanic that is essentially Pyrandus Plus, I guess is what you can say, Pyrandus Plus.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
Yeah, you go through the map and you get to activate some like pylons or towers or whatever it is, and it's going to spawn a bunch of monsters to kill, very similar to Breach. So it's kind of a mixture of Pyrandus and Breach. And then once you've done that, you earn tribute points that you can exchange for items.
I would also add in that in addition to having their own monsters that come with the ritual, it also incorporates monsters that I believe are around the ritual as well. It's sort of a nice combo. Chris did mention in the Q&A that you don't need to pull in monsters from the map, that doesn't do anything, but I believe it's monsters that are in that immediate region will get added in, is my understanding. There was so much information being thrown out that it's difficult to say exactly what's what, but that was my understanding of how it functions.
Okay, so I guess sort of like a shrine, almost sort of like, yeah, like a million monsters around the shrine, right? And then you,
yeah,
go to the shrine,
exactly.
So there's gonna be an inherent like cluster of monsters around there before you even start the encounter.
Exactly, I believe so.
But yeah, I think the best way to think about this new mechanic is essentially a mixture of Pyrandus and Breach, which is a little bit weird, but I guess it works. Yeah, and then something else to note is I think he did mention that like the more rituals you do in a map or whatever, like the more rare the loot is you're gonna get offered from each pylon, because I think he was like, oh yeah, like you'll be able to get like, you know, exalted orbs. You can even get mirrors from this, but I assume that's not going to be very common to get those.
I'm telling you, 3 days into the league, you're going to see a post on Reddit of someone with two mirrors in their shop with a, you know, I used up all my luck for the league. I guarantee it's going to be there. I guarantee it.
Yeah, like 3 days after the league. And then you're just done for the league, right? You just quit at that point.
I don't even know what you do with all that money that early.
Or
it's
like
never happened to me.
And stuff.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
And then there's also this new item called a ritual vessel, which are obtained to essentially capture the essence of the monsters you kill. And then what you do with that is you can re-add those monsters to future ritual encounters. And that sort of reminded me a little bit of how bestiary works, because you obviously capture the beasts, and then you go to the bestiary and you can fight the beasts again there. And this is just sort of the same concept, I think, just like reimagined with this new mechanic.
Yeah, it's very much this, I would agree with that. It's very much the same as bestiary in terms of the capturing function and sort of refighting. And I think it's also very thematically similar to just sort of the expansion as a whole, in that, you know, you're recapturing bosses and fighting them in the arena, you're recapturing mobs to fight them back again in maps. It's this repetition of additive content. I think it's kind of a cool play into each other.
Yeah, so it's sort of like a combination of three different mechanics, right? Piranha's Breach and Bestiary. But something else to also talk about too, about this specifically mechanic, is it's one of these mechanics that's not really meant to be like a standalone functioning thing that you do, like, you know, outside of maps. It's like a complementary mechanic that you do while you're going through the map. You see a ritual pylon, you're like, okay, well, I'll just do this on my way to the boss, right? So it's not like, I guess a way to describe this would be, it's not like Betrayal, where, you know, you're spending like so much time outside of maps figuring out what to do next. Or I guess also Delve would be on the same page as that as well. Like, you're doing Delve outside of maps 90% of the time, because you're actually in the mines. This one is sort of like Breach, Incursion, I guess. Well, Incursion also is a little bit different. I guess it's sort of like Breach, Abyss, Legion, like those sorts of different league mechanics, where you do them as they appear for you. You don't go out of your way to do them, right?
Exactly, yeah. And I think that in the same way that last year when they were running the Awakener and we had Metamorph League, was sort of the complementary league, they're very much in map leagues. I couldn't imagine trying to handle something like Heist in addition to all this new map content. That would just be just content overload for me. And yeah. I just frankly, it just wouldn't be possible to really fully delve in. Whereas Heist functions in a really good way in a little bit later into an expansion, where, you know, I've already killed the Awakener 10,000 times. I don't really care that much about maps anymore. I'll do it because I want to farm it. But Heist is the whole separate thing. Whereas this is very much feeding, it creates like this sort of super map zone where you get a lot of benefit for running maps because you're doing all this new stuff and also this league, which is in the maps. Yeah, it's very much a separate thing.
Right. And then something else they talked about is there's going to be a new item base, or multiple new item bases that come with the Ritual League, which I think is something that we haven't really seen much of added to the game pretty much at all since the game even came out.
Yeah, they'll add them here and there, but they recently redid some wands, but it is few and far between. They don't add a lot of new bases every now and then, and these bases seem very cool. I don't know if this is all the bases. They only showed three so far, yeah. I believe, but hopefully there's some more. I don't know that there is, but either way, something really cool to work with, and people who are crafting, people like myself, are going to have a lot of fun with that.
Yeah, and then the thing that I noticed about a lot of these, and they actually talked about this a little bit in the reveal stream about them, a lot of these items, in fact, all the items that they showed us, they all have really powerful effects on them, but then they also have drawbacks to them. So you're going to have drawbacks on your items, but you're going to have to figure out a way to like live with those drawbacks, because the plus sides that come with them are like ridiculous. Like, for instance, these boots that you're getting, they reduce your, I think they're called Stormrider boots. They reduce your accuracy by 25%, but then they give you 1-6 added attack lightning damage per 200 accuracy rating. So like, is that enough of a boost to force you to stack accuracy rating? And how does that work? Because you're getting 25% less from the boots, but then you're also getting additional lightning damage from it. So it's kind of specific, because you need to be a lightning build for this to even work, but then you also have to stack accuracy rating, which I don't think is something you really want to be doing that often.
Yeah, so seems kind of niche. I don't know. Yeah. I think that they open up the potential for some builds that don't exist right now. It's also hard to say, right, with all of, I know we're going to kind of jump into this in a bit, but the Ascendancy rework, there's all the Ascendancies have had changes. It's, and obviously the passive tree gets changed every league. It's really, it feels like it might exist for a build that doesn't exist yet, or that we don't know about yet. It's something that someone, I'm sure, will make work, because everything can be made to work. But yeah, I, like you're mentioning, I'm not 100% sure on the viability of everything, but I'm sure they have a function somewhere.
Yeah, and so as you mentioned, they talked about in the stream as well, every Ascendancy will be receiving changes, which is a pretty, you know, for just a new league, they probably wouldn't do that. But because this is both a new league and a new expansion in one update, it's kind of like, okay, this is like a big change. So every ascendancy will be getting receiving changes, but specifically the Deadeye, Inquisitor, and Elementalist will be getting the most significant reworks overall, which is interesting because I felt like Scion was one of them that I felt like definitely could have used a rework or more changes. But Deadeye, I think, also was one that they definitely nailed, because the Deadeye has been one that's people really haven't been super high on that one, right?
Yeah, I mean, Deadeye is just, to me, has always felt it's a little bit tired. It needs some love, and so I'm glad they made some changes. I also thought, we had kind of talked about this prior, but I always thought that Deadeye was so simple, and they kind of kept that simplicity in terms of the passives. They're very straightforward. Like one of the major nodes is, I think it's just skills chain additional two times. Like there's really not that much to think about there.
Yeah.
Whereas a lot of the other passives kind of function a different way. Deadeye is very straightforward, which is nice.
Yeah, you look at the Deadeye changes and it's like, yeah, like you just said, I think one of the passives was like projectile barrages have no spread, and like skill chain plus one. And then you take a look at some of the elementalist changes and it's like four paragraphs.
it's very easy.
It's introducing like new mechanics and stuff. It's like, you can do like, you gain like some convergence or something. And it's like, okay, well, I don't even know what that is.
Yeah.
Like it's just,
when you know, you have to hold alt to actually understand what it is, to read a secondary ability that's being added to the game on top of the passive, you know, it's getting a little complicated.
Yeah. And even the Inquisitor, like you take a look at the Inquisitor, like one of them is you gain fanaticism for 4 seconds. It's like, okay, cool. I don't know what fanaticism is.
Exactly. Exactly.
But yeah, they're definitely trying to make things more different. And one of the bigger themes that they talked about as well, or they didn't really talk about this, but they hinted at it during them going over the ascendancy changes, is they wanted every single ascendancy for a class to be viable. Because I think at some point over the past few months, people have just sort of been like it's leaning towards one or two ascendancies for every single class, whereas like maybe that third ascendancy was almost never used. So what they probably did is they probably took a look at the stats for how many, you know, what percentage of the population of this class is choosing this ascendancy as opposed to the others. And if they were like way below the other ones, then they would probably just make them the candidate for a rework. And that's probably how they did that.
Yeah. And I think even within that, they also mentioned that instead of having sort of these cookie cutter ascendancy builds, they really wanted to make sure that every node had viability within each ascendancy. So it's not just, you know, I'm playing this ascendancy, I pick these things and that's it. There's no thought to it. Whereas really they really wanted to sort of change the balance of how that's laid out, so that way you actually want to say, take this ability over this one in certain situations, as opposed to just saying, okay, I'm an Inquisitor, this is the build every Inquisitor does, no matter what ability you're using.
Right. And then I guess sort of we can go into what I consider probably the most important and significant change that's being made to the game. There are now Atlas passives, and they did talk about this in decent detail in the stream. Basically what this is it's almost like super powerful, you know, steroided sextants, I guess is what you could say.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
Because I think it's for each zone of the map, you have like different talents you can spec into, or different boosts or passives you could spec into that affect the different league mechanics, right?
Exactly.
And, so for example, we'll take a look at some of the Breach ones, because my favorite league is probably Breach. Well, not my favorite, it's up there. So, for example, this one, within their grasp. Breach bosses defeated in areas have 5% chance to drop a Breach Stone. Breach Stones dropped by Breach bosses in area have a 9% chance to be charged, 3% chance to be enriched, and a 1% chance to be pure. So, that's just one of the Breach talents. So, basically, what it's doing is you're allowed to choose these boosts, and I think you get access to these points based off of how far you've gone in the mechanic we described earlier with the Maven. Like how many bosses you've killed at once, stuff like that, in those Maven fights.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, basically what their goal is with this mechanic, I believe, and they did talk about this as well, is they want you to focus on the content that you like and that you find more rewarding, because they want you to play the game the way you want to. At this point in the game's lifespan, there's so much stuff to do and there's so many different ways to play the game that, you know, you could play the game forever and not really experience everything. So once you find that one mechanic or that one thing you love to do in the game, they want you to be able to continue playing the game that way and not force you to play, you know, certain league mechanics that you don't like to play.
Yeah, and I think that is an amazing part of this, is that I think something to add in additionally as well is that Chris mentioned, I thought he gave a great line, was that, you know, if you really like Legion, you should be able to do Legion more and have it be more rewarding. And I thought that that was sort of the key indicator, is that it's not just the fact that you get to run legions more, but the fact that you also can enhance legions to make them even better for yourself. That's the kicker right there. I mean, just full customization of the expansion of just being able to say, okay, I really want to do legion, or I really want to do breach, and just doing it nonstop and having it be better than it would have been before. I mean, that's just what more can you ask for?
And it seems to me, just initially looking at the passives themselves, like there's nothing that they mention in the stream or anything indicating that they would stop you from like double, triple, or even quadruple downing on these different mechanics. So for what I mean by that is, let's say you spec into all the breach passives here. So you have Within Their Grasp. I'm just taking a look at the image here. Within Their Grasp, you have Gatekeepers, you have Bountiful Heart. Oh, that's not that heart, that's Harvest. Sorry. You have, so I guess the two right here are Within Their Grasp and Gatekeepers, and you have this one over here, Invading Force. So you have all those three main breach passives. Then you go ahead and, you know, you activate some breach scarabs, you use some breach watchstones, breach sextants. And like, I think the way that this would be the most rewarding for you is if you took one mechanic and you just focus specifically on that one mechanic. Because if you're going into these specs, like for instance, you know, you're making the breaches like 200% to 300% more rewarding for you. So obviously, you know, if you want to double down on the breach, it's going to be way more rewarding than if you did breach and you're like, oh, let's also, you know, let's also influence some, I don't know, legion stuff. You're not even like guaranteed to get a legion thing in the map. So I think like putting all your eggs in one basket, I guess, so to speak, for each of these mechanics, one that you like the best, is the way to go, because you're going to get way more rewards based off of that.
It's going to be very spicy. Very, very spicy.
And then just quickly, I forgot to mention earlier that there are watchstones that are being implemented into the game that are craftable and tradable now. So you can actually do like breach watchstones, you know, legion watchstones. You could even do sulfite watchstones. Like there's a million different watchstones you can actually craft now. So those are also going to have effects.
They only showed three of them, and I can't imagine how many there are going to be, because there's craftable mods. You know, there's got to be more than a dozen possibilities in terms of just individual mod lines. So
yeah,
I mean, who knows really what there could be. Some really cool possibilities.
I mean, who knows? The Maven could even drop like a unique watchstone for all we know. I don't know.
That's true. I mean, Cyrus dropped those unique watchstones, although they were limited use. These ones are infinite use, which is even crazier.
Yep.
I anticipate some significantly expensive watchstones out there with perfect mods. I'm calling it now. It's going to be just like Heist, where you had the really expensive trinkets. There's going to be some really expensive watchstones. I guarantee it.
Yeah. And then something else to note is that Harvest and Heist will both be going core. With Harvest specifically, I know not the entire league is going core. There's only going to be certain parts of it that are going core. So it's not so much something that you need to actively manage anymore. I think what it's going to be is it's just basically a passive mechanic that you just sort of do on your way through the map, basically like how Breach is and how this upcoming Ritual League seems to be as well. So it's a lot less annoying.
Yeah, you just pop in, pop out, pop into the harvest zone, run the farm or whatever, save your crafts, do whatever you want to do, and then get out. Yeah, it's not nearly as annoying as it used to be.
Yeah, and then Heist, I know, definitely didn't really get received super well by a lot of the members of the community, but at the very least you can, you know, completely skip Heist if you want to, because the contracts, you can just sell them. So it's not like they're forcing you to do Heist, and that sort of fits into the theme I was talking about earlier, where they don't want you to be forced to do content you don't like. So yeah, if you don't like Heist, you can just sell the contracts, I guess, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's not really tied into anything else that I'm aware of, so yeah, you really just don't have to do it. Personally, I love Heist, so I'm definitely going to be doing it. But I think if you don't want to, you don't have to.
Right. And then the last thing quickly is there was a short Q&A at the end of the stream. And there was a few points that I had that I wanted to bring up. The first one, we sort of talked about this already. We didn't talk about this yet. The Awakener, they specifically said, is parallel to the new content. So you can still access the Awakener fight, I believe, right?
Yeah, it's functions in exactly the same way, which you kind of would assume just based on the way the watchstones are being incorporated. But yeah, the storyline, the boss fight, it's not changing at all, is what they hinted at. So it seems like it'll just be no changes there.
Right. And then this is actually one of the more interesting things they talked about. And I think for me, this is one of the bigger things that I don't know why this escaped like the actual discussion in the stream itself and why this got to the Q&A, but they talked about a potential implementation of the trade website into the actual game.
Yeah, it was actually asked via, I think someone in chat asked this, and then it got elevated because they were collecting chat questions.
Yeah.
It's not going to be coming with this expansion, and it's not going to be coming, you know, in the near future. Chris mentioned specifically that it's really more of a technical hurdle than anything else of including this. I think he described it as a middleware issue, which is not a term I've ever heard before. Middleware.
But doesn't that sound like, I don't want this to sound like a negative thing, but doesn't that sound a lot like the Diablo 3 auction house, like if they implemented that?
So I think that because the trade website already exists, the trade website's not an auction house, right? It works separately, but I would say that it could potentially do that, but I know that Chris Wilson hates auction houses, so I feel like it's not going to happen like that. If anything, I imagine it functioning literally like an interface overlay where they just took the Path of Exile trade website, turned it into make it look like a Path of Exile, like it belongs to Path of Exile, and then it just functions in the same way. That's how I imagine it would be, but he really only touched on it because I don't think it's even on the pipeline for a long time. So I wouldn't get your hopes up.
Okay. Yeah. And then the last sort of thing we want to talk about just very, very briefly is the fact that the ritual vessels that we talked about earlier that you get from the league, the ritual league, where you can like store monsters' essences and refight them later. He said they're pretty rare. So I guess we'll see what that means. I don't know.
Yeah, he didn't specify exactly what he meant by pretty rare, but when asked whether there was going to be a Ritual League stash tab, because essentially GGG made this announcement saying that anytime there's a league that has sort of a large amount of inventory that's coming out, they'll give you a free stash tab.
Yeah.
And he mentioned that there didn't need to be one for Ritual and that Ritual vessels are somewhat rare. Again, who knows what that means, but it sounds like it's not, I don't think you're going to necessarily be able to just have, you know, you're not gonna have 100 of these by the time, you know, you're level 85 or something. It feels like they're gonna be something you probably need to buy or need to accumulate over a longer period of time.
Yeah, it's not like Metamorph where you have like stash tabs.
Exactly.
Parts, right?
Oh my god, what a freaking disaster that was.
All right, well, I think that covers all the points that we had. Unless you specifically want to add anything else, we're gonna go ahead and wrap this up.
No, that pretty much covers everything. I'm really, really excited for this. This seems like one of the most promising expansions in a long time, and I can't wait to play.
I agree with you. I will be playing as well. We'll definitely try and stream the game over on our Twitch channel. And if you guys enjoyed this content, again, please follow us over on Twitch. Please subscribe to the YouTube channel, as well as leave a comment down below about specifically what you are looking forward to regarding the new Echoes of the Atlas expansion, as well as the Ritual League. As for us, I am Goresh, and I was joined by Amasid in this video. I appreciate you guys tuning into this video, and we'll see you all in the next one.